deep in my heart. Your people's deep in my mind. Your people's deep for us to find. That your balls are deep in me too. In my heart, your people's deep in my mind. Your people's deep for us to find. That your balls are deep in me too.
I had like a near miss. One of the agents that had booked a Gallagher 2 show. You know about the whole Gallagher 2 thing, right?
No.
Okay, so Gallagher like did his act in the 70s, got tired of it. And then his brother, who looks exactly like him, was like, well, can I do the act? He's like, yeah, I don't care. Go. Started making a lot more money than Gallagher 1. After the injunction came down and he couldn't do it anymore, they called me to ask if I would sub for that gig.
Can you do Gallagher's act?
Well, there's an injunction against his brother, but like you could still hit watermelon with it, right?
Oh, hell yeah! Welcome to Night Attack of the Daytime! Night Attack, attacking of the nights. Live from Columbus, Ohio, as I've always been, it's Brian Brushwood, and joining me on the West Coast. And the OAK, it's JRY. What is up, Justin Robert Young?
Oh, man. So where in Ohio are you?
I'm in Columbus, Ohio.
Oh!
Which I
how
believe.
How the warm has turned. I swear to God, man, there is going to be like our own Gregorian calendar that you can mark the passing of 4 years' time when Brian's on the road or Justin's on the road.
Yes, it's when the clock strikes Ohio, get down, boyo. Sorry, no, I got
Well, actually, no, this is going to be back-to-back Ohio episodes because I'll probably be live from Ohio next week in Cleveland for the GOP convention. But right now, you are in Ohio because you are working with the fine folks at Penguin Magic to do a live performance and a lecture. Go to PenguinMagic.com for more information on that, and follow Penguin Magic on Facebook to see your live performance tonight. How you feel?
As I understand, and I'm not 100% sure on this, but I believe that you can watch anybody just by going to their Facebook page. I guess friend them, like them up, or whatever, can watch the show tonight. And then tomorrow I'll be doing a lecture where I'll be talking about how giant chunks of the stage show works, and also giving a little bit of behind the scenes stuff, both on some close up stuff and the stage show. I'm really excited about it because this kind of magic lecture gig, I remember 20 years ago watching like Todd Robbins just give the most rudimentary explanations of fire eating stuff. And from that, it was enough to get me started, you know, experimenting and making terrible, dumb mistakes. But eventually, like I could say that there would not be a Brian Brushwood if I hadn't fallen in love with that magic lecture that I got to see on VHS tape all those years ago. And it's just awesome to think that I'll be able to convey some amount of wisdom to somebody else, although I don't, you know, think it'll be all that much.
Brian, how long have we been friends?
Forever. But we only discovered each other in 2009, 2008.
Many moons. I'm just going to let you know. I know when your butt's tight. You got a tight butt right now. You're a little nervous.
Yeah, I am, just because I care so deeply about, you know, it's weird because, you know, this is the safest of safe spaces here. I could literally, you and I are sitting down with only the loosest, vaguest of plans. And I am confident that we'll have a great time, that we're going to build something over the next hour, and that our folks are going to be entertained. But I don't know if you know this, Justin. magicians. Turns out they're a bit of a critical, irascible lot. I don't know if you heard that.
Okay. I'm going to do, let's do a real quick impression. Brian, you are the best magician on the planet. Just pretend you're him. And you are just ending the greatest illusion ever done. I'm going to pretend that I am a working, practicing magician in the audience. All right?
Okay, so sorry. I want you to picture.
You're in the last final seconds.
Okay. The car is gone! And in its place is an actual fire-breathing dragon! And the dragon is breathing fire, spelling out my long-lost grandfather's name! And the winning lottery tickets! Also, you all just won the lottery! Thank you! Good night!
It's a visual bit. It's a visual bit.
For the audio listeners, without melting his scowl, he uncrossed his arms and got into pre-clap position and then thought better of it and went back to crossed arms. It's a little bit accurate. It's pretty amazing.
This is a real thing, and this is something that, like, if you are a magician, especially because I know that there are a lot of people that come to this show through Scam School, that learn magic through Scam School, that are watching this show because of your personality. I think we can both agree. We implore you that if you ever go to another magician's show, cheer the loudest.
Cheer the loudest. And when he hands you a card, even if you know the trick, especially if you know the trick, and you know there's a secret move coming up, you look him in his goddamned eyes like a gentleman would. You give him the courtesy of saying, I'm not going to burn your fingers. I understand magic's not real, and I want to be amazed, not know that I'm better than you at something. So, I am the best magic person. Like, I'm the Johnny Carson of watching
magic. I went to the Magic Castle
magic
a couple weeks ago, and it was literally just like, I was a one-man Apollo Showtime at the Apollo audience. Like,
you're just standing up, whooping. You're doing the Arsenio dog bark and stuff.
Like, oh, dude, I was just like, if I had a dime for every time I was like, no, 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 oh my god! Like, I would have had like 4 or 5 dimes. Like, it was a couple times. I mean, like, because it is your job to get everybody else live. And I know the people that put these stuff on a penguin, they're gonna find good people. I know that they have done their best to kind of get the best audience. But I got a way, Brian, that you can maybe unwind a little bit before the show.
Talk me through this. What can we do?
Have you been? How close are you personally to catching them all?
Oh my God! You haven't. You've crossed over. You've become one of them. They walk among us as if they are human, but they are not. They pass. They care not for the crude reality that surrounds us. They move as ghosts, caring not for private property rights because they're obsessed. I can't believe you've become one of them.
Listen, Brian, number one, there's not really a choice.
So as I understand it, Pokemon Go is Ingress, but for everyone and with Pokemon, right?
Yes, it's Ingress with Charizard.
And what is the two factions?
There's three. It's like Team Valor, Team Mystic, and Team Who Gives a Rat's Ass. I guess those points are set up from Ingress. So, like, they are based on top of already set up Ingress points and check-ins. Full story. I mean, number one, all right, so if you don't know what we're talking about, Pokemon Go has completely become this massive news story. And we can, I don't know. I played it a little bit. Ashley's really into it. Who knows how long anyone's going to be into it. Here's what I'm fascinated by. This is such a gigantic story that the clickbait headlines are just out of control for it right now. Cause everyone wants a piece of that sweet Pokemon Go news bubble traffic.
So what do they do? People just make up like, this location of the Pokeball 12 will shock you. What comes next?
All right, here. I'm just going to say, and these are just from my memory. I don't even have them in front of me. True or false, this is a real headline. Teen finds dead body playing Pokemon Go.
Oh, I believe that 100%. 100%.
That is absolutely true. All right.
Ready.
Job applications at buildings near Poke clusters, I forget what they called it,
gyms,
have risen. People want to get jobs in places where they will be more regularly close to Poke clusters.
I believe that could be true as well.
Okay, that's false. I just made that one up.
You don't know that it's false. For all you know, it might actually be true.
I know. That actually just might be a 2 month later trend story. That's yes, just not exactly. Like the first week trend story. Pokemon Go headline. Pokemon Go is late capitalism at its worst.
I gotta feel like somebody said that. They're wrong,
that's
though, right?
Actual headline. Somebody look that up. Vox.com published this. This is when you just know that the market for Pokemon Go headlines has completely become saturated. Here we go. Pokemon Go is everything that's wrong with late capitalism. Published by Timothy B. Lee today, this morning, 9:20 a.m. And man, you will not believe what you will learn about global capitalism from Vox.com and Pokemon Go.
Do they have a comment section there on that Vox.com?
They get rid of it? That wasn't that a big thing that like, or was that just on the Verge?
Vox. I know there was a couple of big blogs that stopped having a comment section at all.
I think they just never put comments on Vox because of the Verge's thing.
Oh yeah. So wait. So Brian, you're not in. You're not going to try and catch them.
I actually think I really should be in because I enjoyed playing Pocket Mortys, and you know, because I was in high school. I was too old for high school or college. I was too old for the Pokemon wave when it first hit on Game Boys and so on. I did enjoy diving in a little bit with the Pocket Mortys, but now if it's, you know, my kids are into Pokemon, and I also wanted to get into Ingress, but I never felt like now that I think about it, we'd be a powerful team if we were all the family on the same faction. Seems like we can maybe dominate our neighborhood.
I always thought, I was an Ingress superstar that never got into the game because I was traveling so much. I'm like, man, I could have dominated. I could have spread far and wide. This is a little bit less like Pocket Mortys and certainly more an Ingress type of game. It has a very simple mechanic, but it certainly has people outside of their houses. It's been pretty interesting. I am Team Valor, by the way. I leveled up to level 5 and I chose my faction. That was highly influenced by my wife, who is badgering me that we should be
okay.
On the
so, what are the different things? Because I really dug on Ingress that there was one faction that was all egalitarian and the other one was just anarchist. And so, obviously, I went total anarchist when I was playing on that. But what about does Valor mean anything?
Oh, I don't know. It means you go to red gyms.
We gotta settle
of
this because we need to pick one faction. If I'm gonna get into it, if the rest of the folks are gonna get into it, we gotta know that we're doing the right thing.
All right, then yeah, Valor. Then we're going to be the F Society of Pokemon Go, and we're going to just let all of our Pokemon free at all times.
Speaking of which, did you watch that leaked that quote unquote leaked preview of the first half of Mr. Robot?
That technically, I mean, controlled leak, but they put it out on purpose, and then they pulled it back on purpose, right?
Yeah, that part was the part that made me the happiest. Is they said it'll only be there for a bit, and then sure enough, after I had quoted the tweet, I started getting tweets an hour later saying like, well, what was that? Whatever the tweet is, it's deleted now. And I thought that was pretty badass.
I loved it. I loved the first thing. I binge watched all of it. Mr. Robot, go ahead and watch it. And I know there are plenty of places. If you like me and Brian talking about it, you guys, I'm sure, recapping on Cord Killers and Scott and I will be recapping on Hotline Monday. But you want to know what? This show does not happen without your support. Head on over to patreon.com/nightattack to make sure that we still do this show. Brian, in another place, another world, this might have been a month hiatus. I'm not really joking with people here. Like, this is a hard episode to do. This would definitely be a canceled episode. I got the next 2 weeks in Philadelphia and Cleveland. That, you know, we're going to have to work hard. That one might be a late night one, actually.
You're going to show up like wild-eyed and utterly brain-fried after having shaken Bernie Sanders' hands 12 times. That's going to be crazy. You're going to be crazy. You are an insane person. I'm having you committed.
Okay, all right. Settle down. This happens because you guys pay for it to happen. Thank you guys so much. Patreon.com/nightattack is where you can do it. Please, please make sure that you give us money.
Well, it doesn't even have to be a lot. Just be on the side of people who do something instead of nothing. If you do nothing, that's fine. We hope you enjoy everything for free. But don't feel like we're trying to squeeze you for bucks you don't have. We will take, you know, if you think we make you laugh a dollar's worth once a month, then pledge a quarter. We just want to get our number of patrons up to that magical number, 1776. Right now we're at 1593. We're still, I don't know, dealing with the fall of the Ottoman Empire. I made that up. I don't know if it's probably wrong.
Please support.
We need to move to America.
So support Ernest Lesbian and Knockoff Aladdin as we are pictured in our Patreon video.
Now I look like Fussy Lesbian. Like, oh, what are you doing?
I know. And I look like I just got fired from Disneyland and I'm going to work at Knott's Berry Farm.
So you're doing your impression of the church lady while you do it.
Brian, we had a guest today.
Heck yes, dude. Tell us all about him.
I don't know who he is.
It's Jason Bryant, and I know him just as the person who hosted the podcast awards. He was legitimately my favorite part of the whole thing. He was funny. He had great charisma, and the moment I saw him, I was like, oh, this guy should totally join us on Night Attack. And so our fabulous producer, Bryce Neshcom Castillo, reached out to him. And do we have him on the line? Huzzah!
And there was much rejoicing. First of all, does my sound okay today? Are we good?
You sound perfect. You sound perfect.
Might be a little hot, but otherwise it's good.
Robert Jason Young. How do I sound on your end here?
I'll tell you what. You sound amazing. You sound great.
Dude, I'm just amazed. I'm sleep deprived right now. My second daughter is now 5 days old. So sleep doesn't seem to happen here.
Congratulations. How old is your oldest?
4 years old.
Okay. No, that's great. That's a good spread you got, but man, you're in for it for a while. that's a heck of a time.
Girls. I've got two girls. This is going to be, but 12 years from now is going to suck. I'm just going to lay that out there.
It's funny you should mention that because Brian is 12 years on with 3 girls. So you can look to him for your future and his empty hollow eyes.
Yes. So I can stay in Hilton Garden Inns in Columbus. That's in my future. I'm ready for this, even though I've stayed in worse hotels and worse cities. So, the comedic track takes you different places where the wrestling track takes me glorious places like dorms in Fargo, North Dakota.
Yeah, so talk to me about your podcast and what you cover on your wrestling pod.
Yeah. Oh, and also let's also just get a Jason Bryant is our guest, so we haven't said his name. Welcome to the show, Jason at Jason M Bryant if you want to follow him on Twitter. But sorry, Brian, I stepped on your question.
Oh no! I was just saying, like I was saying, you were the funniest part of the podcast awards, and so I want to know more about your podcast. I don't follow wrestling, so you're going to have to take me.
You're not alone, dude, because you want to talk about a niche audience. That's exactly where I live, which is another reason why I was kind of joking on the show that, I'm not going to win any of those awards because, one, if I were to pool the resources like this Diamond Group did to put them all together and get people to vote, and support it, I'd basically be bastardizing the 14 shows that are on my network and the 10 that I host myself. So that whole thing wouldn't work. And it's like, all right, I'm not going to say like, hey, vote for this show because it's better than the other 9 that I'm hosting or the other 4 people that have shows. Like, well, I'm not going to vote for your show. I'm on your network. I want to vote for my show. So anyway, that was a different thing. So right now I host 10 different shows on college Olympic level wrestling. There's 14 on the network at matttalkonline.com. So the main show I host is called the Short Time Wrestling Podcast, which there you see on your screen. That is the most recent episode with the new head coach at Cal State, what used to be known as Cal State Bakersfield, now CSU Bakersfield. Yeah, get rid of my annoying lead magnet pop-up. And, you know, I talked to notable names in wrestling, new head coaches, athletes, Olympians. I even get in some crossover last year to mark the 30th year anniversary of Vision Quest, which was released in 1985. I had Matthew Modine on the show, Terry Davis, who was the author of the book. And then I had the guy who played Shoot, a guy named Frank Jasper, who's actually now like an acupuncturist in Southern California. So I've had race car drivers. Nate Parker is huge right now with his films that are coming out, Birth of a Nation. He's been on the show. He's been a wrestler. So anybody that's got wrestling backgrounds, I tie in. I just finished up an interview with Chael Sonnen, who's got a show on Podcast One called You're Welcome, well-known MMA fighter. So there's some crossover there, but primarily college and Olympic level wrestling, and that's my wheelhouse. That's where I live, and so, that's what I've done for the last 15, 20 years.
How do you, with 10 different programs, does each program have a different focus? Do you cover different regions? How do you parse all that?
Well, the main idea of the concept of the network was when I was listening to college sports radio. I was on my way to World Team Trials in Madison, and I'm listening to XM radio, and I hear the Alabama football coaches show. And then that's followed by the Auburn coaches show, which is followed by the LSU coaches show, which is followed by Oregon. I'm like, well, shit, wrestling doesn't have this. And I'm thinking about it. I've got a radio background. I did college radio and I worked for an AM station for a number of years doing sports. And I'm like, I think I can do this with the whole podcast thing. So the first show, Short Time, is the third show I ever launched. The last two, you know, they pod faded. I started one in 2008 called Wrestling 411. Terrible name, good content. I didn't come up with the name. It was kind of thrown at us. But the first show is Short Time's kind of I say national, even though I have international guests. That's what's relevant, what's going on right now. You've got, you know, coaching hires, interesting stories. I mean, I've got a guy from the Wrestling Federation head from Nigeria is going to be on the show. He was an Olympic champion from Canada back in 2000. So we're getting the run up to the Olympic Games right now. Then we get into other shows like On the Mat, which is a radio program out of Central Iowa in the Cedar Falls area. That is a radio show that I've been recording for them and posting as a podcast for a number of years. And they're kind of Iowa centric with a little bit of a national feel. And then we get into the team shows. Virginia Tech, it's their coaches show. And this is where that coaches show concept came from. So I've got one for Virginia Tech. It's all about Virginia Tech. I've got one for my alma mater at Old Dominion. I've got one for a small Division III school in Iowa, Buena Vista University. Then we've got different wrestling clubs and camp systems. Like Daryl Weber, who is an NCAA champion in Iowa, has this thing called Attack Style Wrestling. It's DVDs and training kits and things basically for kids and coaches to learn. He uses the podcast as a promotional way to push his product, but also has good guests like coaches and people from maybe MMA to talk about MMA training, or Dan Gable, the legendary Iowa coach, to talk about mental toughness. And then we get into the various leagues, like Virginia USA Wrestling has a show all about their youth marketing system. So a lot of it's grassroots. There is some crossover, but basically each show is about a different topic.
All right. Now, Bryant is a magician. I covered magic. I feel like there's a little bit of a kinship between the two of us in somebody who has spent a lot of time covering a niche industry. Like it has its own little quirks. So like a lot of people who are listening right now probably don't necessarily have a gigantic interest in college and Olympics style wrestling, but I am sure that they have a massive interest in the quirks of something that has to be a very quirky field like college and Olympic style wrestling. If you were to just give a primer to people who have no previous experience with that universe, how would you describe some of the quirky elements of it?
Oh, geez. Where do I begin? Because one thing, it's a very social type of group, because one thing we like to do is drink. After a tournament's over, all the coaches and, you know, I mean, the athletes, when they're done competing, yeah, I mean, we can get rowdy. So there are situations where, as a journalist, and I've been a journalist since, you know, I was 15 years old, I'm using the podcast as a means to kind of focus my coverage, but there are situations I've been in with big names in our sport, and I'm like, okay, I'm kind of here. We're doing some crazy shit. I better just kind of, you know, I mean, it's just some things I kind of keep myself away from things that are too crazy, but we get, you know, we don't always like grab each other and wrestle. I mean, we don't wear singlets around town. Like, you know, those are some misconceptions, but
although I would love it if you did, especially
no, absolutely not. It is not, especially me. I'm an overweight guy. The last time I put on a singlet was the last time I put on a singlet. Okay. I mean, it was one of those things like, you know, there's weird quirks about wrestling people. People love to collect wrestling shoes, even though you really can't wear them anywhere other than a wrestling mat or maybe around your house. My wrestling career ended probably 19 years ago. I've wrestled twice since I graduated high school, and that sucked as an experience because your body doesn't work the way it used to. And you know, you smoke a pack a day and you're drinking a pitcher of beer. You should not be on a wrestling mat. This was in my college years.
So, but, I assume, and in such a niche thing, there has to be moments where you have felt your own undue influence over the community, where you've said something offhanded that either ticked somebody off or got taken the wrong way. Just in the world of magic, if you whisper or if you do a trick, his feet were placed this way. That's the way David Copperfield places his feet. He's a ripoff. And then you have to say, like, no, I met David. I said, hey, is it okay if I stand with my 2 feet this far apart like you do? And he said, that would be an honor. And they're like, oh, okay, we're cool then. I have to assume stuff like that happens.
I didn't realize that about magic. I mean, the only experience in magic I have is it is not the card game, mind you. It was there was a restaurant, a bar in Baltimore I stumbled across a couple years ago. I think it was called Illusions or something like that.
Is that the one? This is we're gonna get into a really weird place.
See, I'm jumping down your rabbit hole.
Look, this is what we're doing. We're doing like life swapping right now, where it's like we're going to introduce you to the minutia of the magic world.
Yeah,
and then I want to hear about the minutia of Spencer Horseman
comes from the Illusions Bar.
Yeah, that's and actually Luke Dancy, who I met via Blab at this place. So I know a little bit about him based on the soon to be the short lived Blab experience, because that place is pretty much just it's.
Wait, nothing. What is that?
Oh, dude, yeah. Did you skip the whole Blab thing? I got invited and appeared on a Blab, ended up doing like a 40-minute interview or stuff. But in order to be on it, it's like an interactive broadcasting platform that had some more like Slack-like elements. Would that be a way to put it, where it's like people could throw animated GIFs and stuff in there?
I think it was more like a kind of open, free-form Google Hangout where you could just jump in, log in. I mean, I was on it about, I think it's pretty much on its last legs now, because I think the company's pivoted, but it was, you know, four squares, you know, jumping in chat room. I mean, it was interesting. I mean, it was good time suck at the end of the night when I wasn't watching like What Culture professional wrestling videos. Cause yes, I do actually pay attention to the, for lack of a better term, the not real wrestling compared to what I cover. So sometimes you get in those rabbit holes, and Blab was good for just the time wasting element at like 2 a.m.
Well, all right. So anyway, let's
off topic. Where were we? No. Anyway.
That's fine. Here, let's get into kind of how our paths crossed. I unfortunately was on the road during all of this, but Brian was watching and interacting, and you were the host of the podcast awards. How would you describe that experience to somebody that had no sense of it?
Yeah, that might be how I describe it. Yeah.
There was a lot of challenges. That's and let me tell you what I saw. There was a number of technical hiccups, but every opportunity where there was air to be filled to keep things afloat, Jason stood up and rose to the challenge. If he needed
and
to,
some of that stuff wasn't funny. And I mean, it's like, you know, I realize that I'm kind of a corny type of guy, and you know, I mean, I'm in the sports ball. I deal with that type of stuff. And even though my sport doesn't involve a ball, but go figure.
Hell, four of them actually.
You know, so I'm sitting there, and actually, it was kind of weird. And I listen to Todd's show sometimes because when he does it live, and I'm up late editing a show, I say, oh, Geek News is on, and I'll listen to it. And he'll say, yeah, I was looking for a host for, you know, the podcast awards. And I remember last year in Vegas and it being kind of a train wreck with Chris Jericho and whoever the Sex with Emily woman was, and two shows I typically don't listen to. And, you know, this is where the funny hat thing started to arise. It didn't even dawn on me then what was going on. It was my first time at a podcast conference, and I'm like, okay, this is cool. And then
there?
Yeah, I was there last year.
So you were in the audience when Brian was calling everybody losers.
No, okay, I just didn't know what my mouth opened, and I'm a terrible, I'm a bad. Look, that's why I was so gracious this year. I was really polite and really gracious this year.
Well, it was the one point, I think I'm sitting next to a guy who does a sci-fi podcast up from Canada, and it right was when Jericho goes, and it was kind of, it was getting to the point where there was some word. I was like, did they just say squirt at the podcast? What the hell? And then at one point Jericho goes, Radio Meth Lab. And my buddy sitting next to me goes, all right, I'm it. I'm done. He just gets up and leaves. I mean, it was like,
so
I think
it just goes.
It was like, this was the end. I was like, all right, this is, you know, at one point I think the MC was going, next category is like http://www.insertshowtitlenamehere.com was like the name. It was like, it was kind of off the cuff. So this year I reached out to Todd Cochran because I've used Blueberry. I've used Libsyn, and I kind of believe what he kind of wants to do with podcasting and in its medium. So I'm like, all right, I didn't have anything set for Sunday, although we were still on baby watch. So I sent him an email about a week prior. I'm like, hey, I'd be interested. I mean, I don't know what, you know, technically my room looks pretty crap. I mean, I got stuff on the wall, wedding pictures, wrestling stuff, Sports Illustrated that I happen to be in. And, you know, I was like, okay, whatever. And he's like, a couple days before, he's like, okay, yeah, you can host. And I had the script. I wrote it out in about 2 days and we just rolled. But what you guys were experiencing, I discovered this through when I rewatched the video that you guys had with the chat. And that was the first thing that was like, okay, who the hell are these guys? So I'm going through and I couldn't hear some of this stuff. So what you guys were hearing on the tech side, half of it I couldn't hear. So the glitches and things. In some cases, I'm just like, at the first video that came through, it was, they were talking. It's like, I can't hear it. So I was like, all right, what do I do? Oh, we got a great podcast here. I was just kind of like throwing, you know, kind of.
Oh yeah. You heard dead air. And so you're like, well, somebody has to fill this dead air. We can't.
I was going to go most extreme. I was going Kenny Blankenship and Vic Romano on that, you know, we're going painful eliminations of the day. That's a reach for somebody that has no idea what I'm talking about. But, you know, and then Todd pops in, don't do that. I'm like, okay, now I realize what's going on. And at some points I just had to roll with it. I mean, I should have probably drank more beers than I did, but I mean, I believe what Todd was trying to do. And, you know, I think some of the things he did, you know, he did rub people the wrong way a little bit. And that kind of irked me a little bit. But then we get to what drew me to this whole, the Diamond Club. And I will say its proper name with the correct brackets in the correct placement. Although I
got to tell you, they've really taken the Diamond Group. They've got
the inverted DG. It's hilarious because I'm like, okay, what's going on? And then there's some people in Twitter that are sending me DMs who are kind of lurking in y'all's IRC room. I'm like, and I take some things personally. I'm like, okay, what the hell? Because I got a 2-day lead time on this. I had really zero. I had as much prep as I could. I made sure I could say the people's names right. Sorry, Jason Robert Young or Robert Jason Young. But I didn't have that one, thankfully. Because I went back after that whole debacle. I looked at my script. I'm like, did I say it wrong? And it was like, oh, okay, yeah. It said it right. So
No. That was not you. Let me ask you this. While it is going on, do you get the sense that things are fraying a bit? At what point does it dawn on you that, like, okay, something's weird. There's, like, some hurt feelings here. This is getting a bit odd.
The hurt feelings I didn't think came until after, but the moment I knew, I'm prepped and I've got everything. I've got the pitch. There's people that were presenting that I had no idea who they were because I don't listen to Disney podcasts. I don't listen, I don't listen to The Diary of a Trans Woman. It's just, that's not my wheelhouse. So I had to research on certain things and whoever the yoga woman was, I didn't know of her. So I had to make sure that the people I was saying or having to present the awards or announcing, I had to get their names right. As a PA announcer, For sporting events, I have to do that constantly. I mean, I had to say Magomed Murad Gadzimagomedov about 15 times at the World Championships last year in Vegas. So it's just, I don't know. That first thing that came through, all right, here we go, boom. And the nothing, it wasn't seamless. I'm like, oh, shit.
Well, and that's the that's kind of a structural problem, right? It's and certainly, you know, you do the best with what you have, but it's one layer to have remote switching taking place literally on the other side of the planet, because I assume you're not out in Hawaii. What part of the U.S. are you in?
I live in Minnesota. I am in where everybody lives, the Twin Cities, north side of St. Paul, a suburb, so right off 694. So anybody that drives through this way on their way to Seattle, because that's the next biggest city west of here, is Seattle. That's where I'm at.
Yeah, so you got the host in one city, on the other side of the planet, you got the switching, and then you have, and this was the difficult thing, is email saying everybody needs to call in immediately so there's no dead air, and also make sure all your tech stuff is set up. And like, Skype is a persnickety piece of software to use. It doesn't, I mean, even though we use it for every freaking show, every so often, you know, it picks up the wrong thing, or it sends the wrong audio device, or picks the wrong camera and all that stuff. And if you're in that moment with no chance to rehearse, it's like there's gonna be massive issues like that. And plus, on top of that, people are almost certainly calling in from the very computer that they're watching the podcast awards on. So you get all the caller turn down your radio.
Well, I mean, let's put it this way. Brian and I mostly do shows wherein we are talking remotely to people, and that's the product. And we screw it up. Like, it is every single and Bryce, our producer, out of a percentage out of 100, how many times do when I first call in, there's either me or you saying, shit, I got to restart Skype.
A lot. Yeah, I screw it up a lot, and I do it every 90%
day. 90%. Like, one of us has not done the one thing, and we know what we need to do. It's just a matter of us doing it on the first try. So the chance that a bunch of people who might not Skype for a living would screw something up is 100. There's no way you're getting through all of that with everything going well.
Well, and the funny part is, normally, in an ideal situation, the host would be in a place where off camera somebody could wave and say, you know, keep going or stop, or you can get a vague sense of what to do. But you when you're talking and you're the one selected, you're only seeing yourself. You're just in a black hole, and all you know is like, well, I'm not hearing anything, so I guess it's time to fill the air. And I loved your ability to just roll with everything. You seemed completely unfazed the entire time long.
Yeah, I mean, I've done, you know, hosting Master of Ceremonies type stuff before, so I don't have a problem with, you know, staring at myself in a basement doing a podcast or a video, kind of like now, and Day Attack or whatever. The timing of this thing is the Night Attack, Day Attack, whatever. Day Man! Anyway, but yeah. we get to doing that. So it's sometimes I'm used to it. I worked in radio. I mean, I've worked in live streaming. I mean, I've been in situations in Budapest and in Tashkent, Uzbekistan, and places where streams aren't working right. And we're like, all right, well, let's just roll with it and get it going. And, all right, we're back. You know, you just can't take a lot of it personally. And then when it's done, then you can take a deep breath. You can decompress and then go back after the trolls who are attacking you, a la Jay and Silent Bob and movie Poop Shoot. But I joke when I say that, but you know, it's just some things you can control what you can control. I think Todd bit off a little bit more than he could chew. I mean, in hindsight, we can look at things and be like, all right, if we would have just had everybody's Skype numbers and called them up when they were ready to go, that would have been one simple solution. But, you know, sometimes you're balancing 1800 things. This award show was dumped. You know, you took it back over because it got dropped unceremoniously last year. It was dead in the water. So, I mean, I give him credit for trying to bring it back for what it was. You know, there was just a few things with it that kind of rubbed people the wrong way. I think maybe the reaction with the technical issues that, okay, well, we told them, you know, a little down talk there. And I've met Todd once. I mean, I've used his company for a number of years, even though primarily most of my stuff is with Libsyn. But yeah, I agree with the idea of what it meant, but I think just the train wreck of it and then trying to bounce time. Nobody wants to sit there and look stupid. I mean, a lot of times this is the first time people are seeing me for the first time. It's like, okay, who's this guy in his basement? Well, yeah, I do live in Minnesota. We have basements. And it's like, okay, who's the fat guy with the beard and the stuff on the wall? Yeah, well, sometimes that, you know, you guys apparently liked it. And if I sucked, I wouldn't be on your show right now. Or if I didn't try to roll with it, I wouldn't be on the show right now.
You brought the energy and you kept the vibe super positive the entire time. It was really, really good. I was going to ask.
And by the way, fat guys talking into microphones with a bunch of crazy crap on their walls, pretty much 90% of podcasting. Like that is a key core demo for the podcasting community. There are more of us than them.
I didn't realize that. How many? Okay, let me think this through. I guess my studio is an anomaly because almost every other podcaster I can think of has a carefully curated arrangement of knickknacks behind them. Daily Tech News Show has it. You have it. Jason, you obviously have it. Leah Laporte had it.
See, I want one of those. I want something like that when I build my studio. I mean, I don't know if I'll go PR40 on it, but it's eventually, see, over on that wall that you can't see over there, there's going to be a secret bookcase door, and I'm going to knock a wall down, and I'm going to have a studio bar so I can listen and sample while I'm listening to Beerists, record my show, and then play darts while I'm at it. and then have it totally locked off from all my children and my wife. So
I'll
eventually have the blue
thing,
padded foam a little bit in some respect.
Get ready for the retreat as your children grow up in age, and you need to have just one goddamn conversation with this client on the phone where nobody's screaming. It's like it's this constant walking away from the children, ducking into the garage. Or I guess in Minnesota, there's entire chunks of the year you can't even walk outside to get away from it all. So you're going to have to find some kind of locked door, soundproof room.
Oh, yeah. I moved up here. I'm originally from Virginia Beach area. And when I moved here in 2008, I'm getting cocky. I'm used to wearing shorts everywhere. So I'm like, all right, I'm living with a buddy of mine. And I go outside to check. It's 29 below at that time. I was like, all right, I'm going to get cocky. I'm going to go out there and check the mail in my shorts and sandals. And I made it to about, wah. I was like, nope. Yeah, you know, people are like, dude, how do you live up there? Just don't go outside. I work from home.
Yeah, dude.
I don't have to go outside.
Yeah, it's definitely the reverse. We had 100 days where it was over 100 degrees in Austin, Texas, and near the end, just irrationally angry. You open the door and you feel like you are leaving the habit pod so that you can go to the alien landscape that is Central Texas.
Man, yeah, weather's weird.
Austin is weird, right?
It's
keep Austin weird. I've never been there. I've heard about it.
It is the best. Jason, thank you so much for joining us. Do you have stuff coming up that you want to talk about?
Yeah, I got a couple things, and I want to finish up the podcast awards thing real quick because at the end of all that, and I just want to finish up my narrative. I was initially annoyed by what I thought was going on, and I think a lot of people were that.
Yeah. What was your worst impression of us? I want just the unvarnished worst impression.
Well, I see it on Twitter, and somebody's sending me links, and look at this, and it was the video that somebody had sent to Todd and said, yeah, we told you about this last month. And what was interesting enough is the person who was complaining, I mentioned this in the IRC chat a couple of days ago, I don't even think they were eligible for an award because they started their show in February, not before January. But that's another topic entirely. That's just vetting the process. So I'm sitting there going, okay, what'd they do? What'd they do? I look, did it autofill? Was it one of these bots that people try to spam, I think there was an episode of Sports Night that Ad talked about that like in 2002. Well, yeah. I'm sitting there looking at it. Then I go back and look, and then I find the chat. I'm like, okay, how do I log into IRC? Because it had been a while. And I was sitting there, and I'm starting to watch. I'm like, okay. And then I'm going back, and Todd had pulled the video after all this. So I went back and found somebody sent me the link to the Diamond Club video with the chat like on the bottom of the window here. Yes, Pocosin. Nobody's ever heard of it. Why does anybody know this? Why does anybody in the chat know my freaking hometown? Pocuson. Anyway, I'm from a redneck little town in Hampton Roads area. So I'm sitting there looking at this, and I start digging into it, and I start reading the comments, like right here. I start reading the comments. I'm like, okay, fat guy, okay. Does his mom know he's broadcasting from his base? So initially, I got a little worked up, and I was like, all right, I'm going to keep watching. And then ultimately, I think there was a moment. It was like, I think the fat guy's kind of funny now or, something like that. And I think it was when I just started slamming my beer. I'm like, all right, looks like I'm not taking the abuse anymore. And then afterwards, I think I was up for another 4 hours just kind of digging up everything I could and kind of understanding things. And I realized, wait a minute. Oh, I do listen. I've listened to Beerist for like a year. I used to listen to the morning stream after NMX last year. Got me listening to it again. So in the wake of all of this, I kind of my attitude kind of calmed down. I was like, oh, okay, it's just a tool. Granted, I would have loved to have had that tool. I don't have the programming knowledge to do it. I'm in wrestling. I really don't have a lot of people that could do something like that.
Hey, brother, neither did we, which was the funniest part about it.
Yeah. Damn, it's like Linkovich Chomosky
from the Lord.
But so we're finishing it up, and I'm just, and then I discover this show. So I'm like, okay, who the hell is Night Attack? The prank call episode where you guys are dialing in the numbers like, press 1 if you mean yes. Press 2. Yeah. I was like, this is hilarious. And then I've already listened to the Beerists. I'm a cord cutter, so Cord Killers was right up my alley. So after all this, I discovered about 5 or 6 new shows that I'm now listening to regularly. So even with whatever scandal may have existed, as a podcast listener and consumer, I've got more content to listen to through this. Had this thing never thrown up on my Twitter feed, I would have had no idea. I mean, I knew about the morning stream because I met Bryant at NMX last year. But this show, Cord Killers, I mean, I knew about Beerus. I reviewed it last year, and I kept listening to it. And I'm like, there's so many – your show, Jury? I mean, I'm like, yeah, This is stuff, I mean, I listen to because of this podcast awards issue.
Well, JB, thank you so much for that, man. I mean, that's something that was really exciting about everything is for whatever. And I think that, you know, the scandal, quote unquote, is something that, you know, is going to be as big of a deal as people want to make of it. And I personally don't think it is something that needs to live beyond the week that it was hot. But the thing that was awesome about it, and I do hope lives on, is that there were so many people that came into the fold that were really like, that really dug it, that just heard about it and wound up coming in to watch it. We got a bunch of traffic on the Reddit. We got a bunch of people new in the IRC, and hopefully a few of them have hung around. So I'm glad that you were part of that migration.
Yeah. Speaking of which, Jason, do you live stream when you do your podcasts, or do you just record?
Very rarely, because I'm dealing with people that aren't necessarily tech savvy. So I'll have them, a lot of them are on cell phones, and getting them to do Skype or Zencaster or even now Cast. It's sometimes I just want to make sure it's balanced. And now with another baby in the mix, my timing, like I had to make sure that I could get just the hour to set this thing up. So I could do it. I had an interview right beforehand, so I'll have that released. But typically, I've got certain episodes will record certain days, and then I'll do them. But post-production allows me to get that intro, that outro. If I want to pitch something like my Patreon, for example, or things like that, or my mailing list and things like that. So I like the post-production. I can do it live. I have experience doing it live. I just, for my workflow, I don't want to have to add that extra editing step to it. If I say, oh shit, I got to edit that part out of the show, you know, edit point, you know, I can just do that without even making a point about it. So I prefer to do it in post, but I can do it live. I know how to do it live. I have all the technology to do it live.
That's a very, very good point, because there is a certain rhythm to, let's say, a Scam School episode where it's like the moment anything comes out wrong, I just pause and restart the same phrase because I know everything's going to get super chopped in the edit. Whereas this is much more like a live stage show. Whatever gets said. And there have definitely been left turns that both Justin and I have made that if we could have called backsies, we would have. But not so much a possibility in this format. But my point being that if you do any live streaming or stuff, you know, just show up in the chat and let folks know. And I'm sure they'll end up putting you in one of the channels on there so that, you know, it's as much as we like to act like this is our clubhouse, our family, but it's like, you know, the lunatics are the ones running this asylum, not us.
Yeah, and the thing is with the live streaming, I wouldn't do a video. That's the one thing. It's because the video, I did a lot of video editing when I was working for USA Wrestling, which is our national governing body. It's that puts together the Olympic team. So I know I've done the video editing. I've done the live video stuff. I've just, you know what? That's why I like the podcasting. I've been broadcasting for a long time. I feel like I still treat every show like it is. I prefer to have no edits. I mean, I'll basically try to go live to tape as best I can. So it's just something that I'm comfortable with and it's, you know, live is cool, but, you know, I mean, I did a live show with my first podcast in 2008. I mean, we got 12 listeners typically. And then right now I can't have a set schedule, especially now with a newborn and a four-year-old and summer and nannies. And, you know, my travel is crazy. I mean, I'll be in Brazil for 3 weeks. I go to Fargo on Sunday for the junior nationals, and that's the tournament I've been going to for 18 years. And then I go to the Olympics on August 8th and I come back the 24th. So, I'll be out of the country for 3.5 weeks. So things like that aren't conducive for a live schedule.
When you're doing all these events, how often are you ever, you mentioned that you do live PA work. Are you sometimes covering, you know, acting as like a hype man announcing? I mean, I guess they probably don't do that at the Olympic level.
It's not really a hype man. It's not, I'm not warming up a crowd or anything, but I've been doing public address announcing for various sports since I was 14 years old. I've always wanted to be in sports broadcasting. So where I was from, we didn't have a radio station at our high school. Some places did. A small little marsh fishing community. They had PA systems though. They had them. So I started doing baseball as a freshman, you know, now batting number seven, you know, that stuff. And then the next year, soccer coach got a hold of me. Then the basketball coach. Then by the time I was a senior, I was doing 8 sports. And I was still wrestling and I played a year of football. But then I get into college, I do that. And I just started doing the PA, and it's something that I've done. And I had the NCAA championships this past year. They were in Madison Square Garden, so that was kind of a rush. I had the world championships in Las Vegas last year. I've got the Olympics this year. So when I do an event, I've had the Midlands, which is a big college tournament. It's basically, you know, who's up on the mat, you know, introducing school colors and, you know, on mat 3 at 125 pounds from Iowa, Matt McDonough, his opponent, you know, that type of stuff. And then when they're on the action, there's eight mats going on in some cases, and you're just calling the action, you know, 3-1 lead for Robles on two. We'll go over to three. You just, you kind of keep rolling because there's, you know, so many people watching. And that's just something I've gotten into, and I've had pretty good opportunities with it. But that's basically just letting people know what's going on, because not one person can pay attention to everything that's going on. Oh, possible fall on three. Everybody ducks their head over there. Or if you hear a roar of the crowd, you draw the attention to where the crowd is. So it's kind of a rush to be in that situation.
Let's finally, we've had enough preamble here. Let's go to why we brought you on the show. The Olympics are happening. You are going down to Brazil. This is again beyond the college level. This is the biggest stage for your style of wrestling, right? The Olympics.
This is the pin. I mean, there is no professional league for wrestling that actually has any viability. I mean, the only time we see people, we've seen Brock Lesnar go into professional wrestling. We've seen Kurt Angle, Chaz Betts, who is an Olympian in 12. He's now he's Chad Gable in the NXT. You know, if you're into that, Jason Jordan, his tag team partner, wrestled at Indiana under his real name, Nathan Everhart. So there's that, but you can go there and make money and go to the MMA or make money. But the ultimate is the Olympic gold medal. That you can't go any higher than that. And
Years. This is the official Night Attack Olympic wrestling preview segment.
There will never be another one, by the way. This is the first and only, right?
Well, listen, we're here. So
bring
just,
me on in 4 years.
Give us a name to look out for this year at the Olympics.
Easily, by the way, Jordan Burroughs. Jordan Burroughs, okay. Best wrestler on the planet.
Jordan Burroughs. All right, now, Brian, break down Jordan Burroughs. Why is Jordan Burroughs going to make a name for himself here at the Olympics?
Oh, this is the Night Attack Hot Take segment. Jordan Burroughs, as you know, one of the toughest wrestlers around. He is real strong and can hold another person down on the mat for at least three. We never get to find out how long he can actually hold him down for. Because they
count
they,
the
in fact,
three
they cut
in pro wrestling. They'll count the three.
Every time. Let him go.
In college and Olympic level wrestling. One. Because you know how hard it is to actually hold somebody's shoulders down on the mat? You know, they flop it around, this little kick out stuff. Once you do the real stuff, I can say shit on this show, right?
Sure.
I mean, you already have a bunch of
Once you do the real shit, you realize how much that the TV stuff is like, really? You're going to lay. Okay. Yeah. So anyway, but yeah, to expound on that. Jordan Burroughs has only lost two matches in his career. He's won three world titles and an Olympic title already. And he's a badass. Another name, Adeline Gray on the women's side.
Hold on, wait. Stick to the
first one. Adeline Gray. Brian, break her down.
She was just in the ESPN body issue. Hint, hint, nudge, nudge.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad she got beyond her body issues. I think that
I don't think she has any, if you can see right there.
Wrestler. I think that her signature move, the windmill of pain, is
you're actually close. You're close.
Okay.
I don't think windmill of pain. I'm gonna write that down. I might actually use that.
See, what I want to do is, what is something that every wrestler does that we can name and freak out whenever we see it, but that doesn't have a name and is not an important thing. Like, I don't know if it's I imagine a gymnast maybe chocks their hand and shakes their hand twice.
I've got it. Okay, this doesn't happen in American wrestling very often. Now, if we're the international style, so in between periods, there's two periods in an international wrestling match, 2 3-minute periods, and there's a 30-second break in between. And internationally, you'll see these coaches, they'll take this towel and they'll just like whap, so that they have the real two tight ends close, and then they throw it out. And it expands, and it like whips air in their face, and you'll see them go whap 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 whap. And you'll see people talk about, dude, look at the towel waving towel. There is no name for it.
Okay. We're watching it during
the Olympics, and you'll see an old Russian coach who's at 70 years old sitting there with a towel going whap whap whap. You're just like, you're gonna shit yourself because it's like, what is this guy doing?
Okay, so we need to start an urban legend that what they're doing is the ancient tradition of adding chi. It's believed that they're actually refilling their mana bar. No?
No, I think it's the ancient fear that in the highest level of competitions, you're being inhabited by evil spirits. And so you need to get it out by way of this blessed towel.
See, that's weird because I thought...
They're actually just cooling you off, but we can go with that.
It's well known that wrestlers, as a rule, are terrified of towels. And by being able to face their own fear, they finally build the courage. You know, once they've had a towel come at them, it's like they're not afraid of the opponent anymore.
I actually, it's funny that you should mention that because I heard it's because the only true way to test your courage is to keep your eye open fully without blinking while a towel snaps close to your eyeball. And that's the only true way. Sure, this wrestling is a substitute, but really you're there to demonstrate how close you can get a snapping towel to your eyeball.
Don't forget to bring a towel.
I don't know. That's all I got to say. I mean, that's not. Tally has a job now. He works in Rio.
Yes, exactly. All right. So, what are we going to call that move? We got to come up with a name for it.
That's on you guys. I mean, you guys are bringing it up. So, I mean, I totally. I can't. I can maybe bring this into wrestling through your help. So, I got a pretty good Twitter following. So, maybe, you know, we got to have some purists that are probably going to disagree. But you guys are. You guys are. You come up with things off the cuff, so I'm at the mercy of the Diamond Group here.
I'm fine. I'm feeling the thunderflap.
Thunderflap. Okay.
I like that. I like thunderflap. I like slip slap.
I don't know. I've had thunderflap can also be confused with flatulence.
You know what? Maybe that's what it is. Is they're afraid. Sometimes the wrestlers will let one crank one out as they leave. And they don't want anyone to know it's him, so they thunderclap away.
How about a fabric fart? Are we down with fabric fart?
No, that's just that nobody will believe. I want some that people might believe, like, oh man, that's good thunderclap. Oh,
Whiskey Wolf points out, how about a whap on him?
Tell faps.
A whap on.
Was it? Was it Fetty Wap? Fetty Wap? What is it?
Fetty Wap. Yes.
I don't know.
You could be the trap queen of the Olympics.
I still like Thunderflap.
I like Thunderflap. So here's my dream. My dream is this, is that we're about to get into the Olympics. And like what happens during the Olympics is you have a lot of people that are watching just randomly, and they wind up becoming enamored and fascinated with sports that they otherwise would not care so much about. I'm sure for your podcast, there's a reason why you're going down to Rio. These are the most popular times for your sport. I want Diamond Club. I want all of our collective audience to be specifically focused on the wrestling. And whenever you see any kind of thunder flapping caught on television, you record it, you alert us on Twitter, you just hashtag thunderflap. If hashtag thunderflap can trend during the Olympics, it would be the greatest thing on earth.
Oh, hold on. I just want to take the Twitter. Let's see, go over to the tweet deck right now. Let's see. Just, I mean, I should have vetted this thunderflap.
No, let's see.
Is it a hashtag? Not. It has been a hashtag for 857 days. I think we're good.
All right. Dude.
So we own thunderflap.
Thunderflap. And I will get my Blood Round boys on that. They do some, 800. I mean, how many days is this? We graduated. Thunderflap. It's, I don't know.
2014 looks like
one whatever.
Of the last. I mean, Todd Albert, man, you're the last of a dying breed with the thunderflaps. Whatever Pie Panic is, and anyway.
Thunderflap.
Didn't quite have the staying power. I think that startup not quite successful on Indiegogo.
Dude, this is gonna be great. Every time, and I'll tell you what. You will get so many props if on any broadcast, anything that's recorded, if you could just work in, just call it like it's obvious everyone should know what it is. It's like, you know, mention that the coach was thunderflapping. It was amazing. And then
the problem is as if the PA, I'm not on TV. And with Rio in the Olympics, there's such a rigid thing. If I got to be very careful with the script. Now, I might be able to tweet it or get people to mention it certain places. But
No, this is
I could probably get that in like the NCAA championships. However, there has to be somebody that listens to Night Attack or Diamond Club actually at a wrestling event. And I don't think there's that many people that are in this crossover audience. So
this is the first step of a journey of a million miles. We just begin now. We are bringing thunderflapping to the internet and then America. And then, my friend, we will canonize the world.
Oh my God. Can you imagine?
I'm going to really see if I can find a video on this real quick, just to explain what it is.
I
typed in thunderflap. What the heck? Am I stupid?
those thunderflaps.
Yeah, man. I just want 4 years from now, next Olympics, for Bob Costas to casually say, coach, obviously, a little bit of thunderflapping, taking care of getting him back in the groove.
Yeah, how did the thunderflap work between periods there? I mean, you came out pretty slow in the first period, got the thunderflap. Coach Petrosian was right there with you. I mean, what was the difference?
Well, you know, Coach Petrosian thunderflapped me very good. I go and crush American.
And it just becomes this weird meme where people are chanting thunderflap each break. That'd be awesome.
Dun, 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 dun. And you could actually kind of maybe pirate the Thundercats theme every time they dun 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 dun. You know, I mean, Panthro looks like he could be a wrestler.
Thunderflaps are on the loose.
Not to be confused with the thunderclap, because you'll definitely need a shot of something to clear that.
Yeah, or thunderstruck.
Well, I did see AC/DC live a couple months ago, so I'm happy there. Thunderstruck's good. Good for me.
Hey, man, if you want to hang around with us, we're about to dive into our movie draft. I don't know if you know about this, but we do we have our movie draft minute, Mr. Bryce?
We do have draft. One.
Sounds intriguing.
All right, well, let's take a look at the Movie Draft Minute.
Welcome to your Movie Draft Minute, presented by CosmicRadio.tv for the week of July 4th, 2016. I'm your host, Roberto Villegas. Folks, if my voice sounds a little different, that's because it's still recovering from RTX. So without further ado, let's go check the scoreboard. Team We Have Concerns is in sixth place with $136.6 million.
Oh, you know, excuse me, I think this is last week's.
Yeah, I was about to say, that's his new bit, is always talking about his voice, I guess.
I had like eight people tweet me the link. Hold on, we've got it right here.
Yeah, Blender MF tweeted it earlier.
Welcome to your Movie Draft Minute, presented by CosmicRadio.tv for the week of July 11th, 2016. I'm your host, Roberto Villegas. Well, it's a bit early for me and a bit strange because I'm recording this on the iPhone, but without further ado, let's check the scoreboard and see if anything's changed. Team We Have Concerns is in 6th place with $140.2 million. Team Cord Killers is in 5th place with $433.2 million. Team DTNS is in 4th place with $510.4 million. Team Nitech is in 3rd place with The Secret Life of Pets, bringing $104.2 million, bringing their total to $582.9 million. Team Chainsaw Suit is in 2nd place with $627.6 million. And in 1st place with $644.1 million. It's Team M-Trekker, and that is your Movie Draft Minute for the week of July 11th, 2016.
Dude, sorry, Dad Trekker. Sorry, Chainsaw Suit. You guys are out. You have no more movies making any money. We still have Ghostbusters in the tank, and Secret Life of Pets outperformed Finding Dory's opening weekend. That's amazing. And generally positive reviews. Both of them are 75%. Our only competition is DTNS, man. DTNS might surprise us because they got Star Trek Beyond. If Suicide Squad is the next Guardians of the Galaxy, then we may have trouble, but I think it's looking pretty damn good.
I think we'll see what The Secret Life of Pets. I mean, this is our weekend, right? Like, we know whether or not we win based on this weekend.
Yes. And keep in mind, Ghostbusters has the chance to take the high, you know, the adult end of the market, and because it's what, PG-13 or just PG?
PG-13.
Yeah. Okay. So it has a chance to take the adult side of the market, and Secret Life of Pets, if it has any kind of staying power, dude, it's we're on track to break 800 million, which is a possible winning slate.
I mean, basically, we needed both of them to do what they were going to do, and Life of Pets did way beyond what we thought it was going to do. Like, this is almost certainly going to make $200,000, if not more. Finding Dory, again, this did better than Finding Dory in its first week. Who knows if it'll have the staying power? But, you know, in general, kids movies don't tend to have, just total fall apart the second week. So,
right. Jason, so basically, if you haven't figured out, we're just playing fantasy football with the movie drafts. And
I have noticed We Have Concerns has pretty much mailed it in for the year. So are they even trying anymore?
Yeah, no, they're out of everything. Well, I take that back.
No. They got two. They got two late movies, Ice Age and Jason Bourne.
They're like Detroit Lions of this league. They're eliminated by week four.
Yeah, no. You should join us. We do a winter draft and a summer draft. So we'll make sure to reach out to you and give you an invitation.
I'm game for that because I used to watch a ton of bad movies in my day, and I used to spend a lot of time on Thursday night with that midnight premiere, going to see Evan Almighty with one other person in the theater. So
If you were ever sitting in those Evan Almighty showings and you were thinking, man, I wonder what the multiple on this will be, then this is the thing for you.
Okay. Yeah, because that and the Aqua Teen Hunger Force movie, I really have very little recollection of it. But yeah,
oh, my God. The Aqua Teen Hunger Force movie was so great. And that super trippy opening where it starts playing death metal, telling you to shut your kids up. That was amazing.
Yeah, Tina Fey is a burrito. Like I said, I'm really sketchy on some of the... I might have been intoxicated at the time, so I don't know what my memory of said movie might be. I just remember that being one of five people in there. I did see Snakes on a Plane opening night. I was really sorely disappointed.
I saw that.
That one didn't quite take off.
Turns out the movie was crap. You know, the one movie that everybody was
wild
about because it was going to be crap. Turns out it was crap. Huh.
Yeah. Diamond Time is your opportunity to get your project shouted out right here on Night Attack. Just head on over to diamondclub.reddit.com and get your story voted into one of the top three of the sticky posts right up top. And we'll talk about your project just like this from Leon, who says, hello, there's a new elementary school being built in my neighborhood and they could use a little help getting started. Central Park Elementary has entered a contest to get some Piper computers. A Piper is a Minecraft themed Raspberry Pi based system that teaches kids how computers work. All you have to do to help Central Park Elementary is to watch and thumbs up their YouTube video at yolo420.com/piperswag. That's P-I-P-E-R-S-W-A-G. There are prizes for the video with the most thumbs up and the most views, so why not do both?
Yeah, look at that, man. All you got to do is watch a video and give it a thumbs up. We can do that. That's free, son. Also from Loridine. Hey there, I started a podcast a while back called Never Got Around to It. While aimed to motivate me to do all the geeky things that I should have done a long time ago, like watch Firefly, play Final Fantasy VII, etc., by finding guests who have never done them, so we we can not only review them together, but also talk about why they're such a big deal in nerd culture. Jury is supposed to be a guest in the first few episodes, but I decided to eat a big bag of dicks instead of being a competent audio technician, resulting in one of the one-side conversation being recorded. Uh-oh. Anyway, I took a big break in the releases since I slipped into a slight existential depression, and now it's back on. The first of the new episodes launches last Saturday. It's about Neil Gaiman's Sandman, starring Callum from the Rosalites podcast. Anyway, now for that, you can find it at yolo420.com/nevergotaroundswag. It's also on iTunes and Stitcher. And please reach back out to me. I'll be back on the show. I remember we recorded a whole episode about Doctor Who, and then it wasn't recorded, but I didn't have time to go back and re-record it. So hit me back up. We'll do it again.
People are saying we should refresh. I see.
So there's one here from Wanyam. How about we do that? That was
You know what? Take that away, Bryce.
Yeah. Hey, everyone. This is Wanyam from the chat with a podcast to push. It's called Have a Drink, and it's another beer and alcohol-related podcast. How is this one different? It has me and my friends on it. Okay, so that's one strike against it, but it's educational. Okay, that's strike two. I better quit while I'm ahead. Still, surprisingly, the show has turned out pretty good. I may be biased. Me and my friends, Chris and Brittany, try to learn a thing or two about beer and pass that knowledge along to anyone willing to listen. We talk about styles, breweries, home brewing, and beer events where we drink too much, in addition to anything that tickles our fancy alcohol related. I also try to work in some reference to the Diamond Club once per episode because nothing builds a show like references to another show that the audience may or may not know about. Come check us out at haveadrinkshow.com or bit.ly/YOLOHaveADrinkSwag420. That's lowercase. Thank you, everybody.
All right. Real quick. Also, because he has been such a gigantic supporter of this show, M. Kapelke writes, howdy there from sunny Australia, Diamond Club friends. I wanted to ask for the DC support with my nomination in the 2016 Weight Watchers Healthy Life Awards, the Healthies. Some of you may know, I've spent most of my life battling with obesity. In the last couple of years, I've managed to take control of that aspect of my life. This year, I was encouraged by my Weight Watchers coach, Lee Everett, to nominate for the Healthy Life Awards, which aim to recognize people who have either reached their goal weight, not me, or are still on the journey, but possibly have an inspirational story to tell, possibly me. It would mean a lot to have the backing of the Diamond Club, as I honestly believe I have a strong story to tell if I win and want to have the chance to help others in my situation, particularly men who don't tend to join Weight Watchers because of their gender perceptions. As I can best tell, the finalists are calculated from a combination of a judging panel combined on which profiles get the most Facebook likes. So while I cannot influence the former, I'm hoping Diamond Club can help me with the latter. Voting closes this Friday, July 15th. You can read the full version of his story at YOLO420.com/healthyswag, including the gory details of how I used to hate myself for being so overweight and some awesome fat me photos from a few years ago. The journey has saved me from a life of depression and self-hate and would mean a lot to me with any support that can be offered. Thanks in advance to anybody who likes my page, Diamond Club Forever. Let me also just say here, Mr. M. Kapelke has been a supporter, not only in terms of his enthusiasm, but monetarily of this show for a long time, and especially when we first launched on Patreon. I would very much be excited if he was able to get something with the help of the Diamond Club. I know I am going there right now to like that page.
Yes, yes, yes. 100 billion times yes. Hey, before we wrap up, Jason, what's the one place we want to send everybody to check out more of your stuff?
At matttalkonline.com. Simple spelling, M-A-T-T-A-L-K online.com. I'm on Twitter at Jason M. Bryant. You can follow the Matt Talk Online Twitter account. But yeah, there's my new arrival. That is Ruby Rio. My older daughter is Lucy London. You're picking up a theme here because my wife and I have only had kids during Olympic years. You know, there will be no Tammy Tokyo. I'm 36 years old. I think we might be done with the Olympic years unless they
bring
up some.
Dude, I was about your age when I was saying the same thing. Then a third baby happened. Dun, 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 dun.
Yeah, well, I've already been to Brazil once, so I don't know if I have Zika or not. So that is always a fallback excuse. Well, I don't know. So, but yeah. But yeah, matttalkonline.com. And again, I have interests other than wrestling. So that's obviously why I listened to this show before I even, like, you know, was even prompted to come on this show. But yeah, that's pretty much where it is. I've got a decent Twitter following. I mean, I block all the porn bots, so it's not like I'm paying for followers by any means. By the way, that picture, that is the wrestling venue that they will be competing in, Karaoke Arena 2. That's me at Madison Square Garden. I'm pointing things out. Yeah, for those of you listening and not watching, I'm totally ruining your experience.
No, this is good. You're telling this is the hallmark of a true professional who understands has to paint the pictures that the audio listeners are going to see.
Yes, and that Baron Arena is where the wrestling will be contested in Rio, Karaoke Arena 2. I did like the Madison Square Garden picture, like the big ambiance, but I mean, 18,000 people watching wrestling is kind of cool. And for once, I didn't have to attack those singlet jokes here. So that's where I'm at. Jason and Brian on Twitter, hit me up with anything. I mean, I like general sports, stupid stuff, bad movies, worse movies. I like have not Hitler downloaded movies, Pokemon, nor will I. The only Pokemon I know is that the yellow one's Pikachu. I just refer to him as the yellow one. And that's it.
All right. All right. Look, I got to go. I have to download Pokemon Go. Thank you to everybody who showed up for our daytime night attack. It's always night somewhere. Just Robert Young, you got anything else?
One big thing. Of course, we mentioned Diamond Time is at our Reddit, reddit.com/r/diamondclub or diamondclub.reddit.com. But there is a vote right now. The man who made the Hatting the System site and one of the, you know, just the patron saints of our community, T2T2, has a little survey about whether or not we as a collective community should maybe take our own awards to another level. If this is something that you're interested in, just go ahead and take the survey. Even if it's like, not worth the time. Just go ahead. Let's take a little cross-section of our community to see how interested people are.
Right on. Wow, man. Look, I guess that's it for this episode. That hour just blew past. Now I got to get ready. I have to get clean and practice all my magic moves. Rebuild my torches.
Well, that's about it, Brian. You are going to be on Penguin Magic's Facebook page. Everybody can watch you live. If they are in Ohio and they are watching live, then get your ass to Columbus. Otherwise, my name is Justin Robert Young. You can follow me at Justin R. Young. Any last words, Brian?
No, dude. Just die in a fire, beautiful people.
See you next Tuesday. I'm gonna hurt myself by pissing off some bees. I'm allergic to bees. Oh, Justin Robert Young. Every time you go, I get so sad.
that I wanna drink a warm glass of Drano. Night attack,
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 night
attack. I love you.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.